God bless you this morning to all, to everyone that are listening on the live screen from all over the world. This is a great day that a blessing has been set apart for you, and there's a great teaching today. So we're going to ask each and every one at this time to stand and let us just look, pray in prayer. Our Father, O God, we give you praise this morning. We thank you for gathering us together. And your people from all over the world, we are all here gathered into one great congregation, worldwide congregation. And we are just here to hear from you today and to give us a heart and a mind to receive your teaching and your instruction. We thank you, Father, for your servant for such a time like this that we are in this age. Father, we just thank you for what you are doing all over the world and bringing your people together. We thank you and praise you and magnify your great name in Yeshua's name. Amen.
Amen.
Life and salvation is in our shadow.
together. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Praise be the name of his glorious sovereignty forever and ever. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. And these words which I command you this day shall be upon your heart, and you shall teach them thoroughly to your children. And you shall speak of them when you sit in your house, when you walk on the road, when you lie down, and when you rise. You shall bind them for a sign upon your hand, and they shall be for a reminder between your eyes, and you shall write them on the doorposts of your house and upon your gates. When the word entered the world, freedom entered it.
The whole Torah exists only to establish peace.
Its highest teaching is love and kindness.
Love the Lord your God with all your heart, and what is hateful to you, do not do to any person.
That is the whole Torah. Go and learn it. Honoring one another, doing acts of kindness and making peace, these are our highest duties.
But the study of the Torah is equal to them all, because it leads to them all.
Let us learn in order to teach.
Let us learn in order to do.
It is a tree of life to those who hold fast, and all who cling to it find happiness. Its ways are ways of pleasantness, and all its paths are peace.
Help us to return to you, O Lord. Then truly shall we return.
Renew our days in the past, the days of our first love.
Amen. If we can have the kids come forward here. Amen. And those people that are live streaming with us, I recommend parents, if you're there with your kids, get your kids together and give them a big hug. And we want you at this time. Right before we started, I looked and we had almost 160 cities from like 20 countries around the world live streaming with us right now. And so we just encourage this. El Shaddai really is all about to you. It's all about those live streaming around the world as well as here locally. It's all about your kids, our kids. They're really all God's kids, aren't they? So let's extend our hands toward them, pray for them, and you pray for your kids at home. Father, we just thank you so much, and we just want to just have your arms wrap around all of these kids that are here and around the world and show them how much you love them. We thank you so much for the teachers that are here locally. They're going to be imparting your Torah and the truths of your word into these kids that they could come into an early loving relationship with you. And for those parents, Father, we just pray a blessing upon those parents around the world that are extending their hands over their own kids, that they would teach their kids the Torah, and that you would bless them and show each one of these families live streaming as well how much you love them. Father, protect these kids. We just lift them all up to you, and we just ask, Lord, that through your Ruach HaKodesh, your Holy Spirit, you would just permeate this building and those homes that are live streaming. This is your Shabbat. This is your day. And we thank you that the very day that they're keeping Shabbat in heaven, hey, we're all keeping it here as well. And so, Father, I just thank you for your kids. Bless the teachers and bless them. In Yeshua's name, amen. Amen. Are you ready? Fasten your seatbelts. Let me get a drink of water. I don't talk too fast, but I still need water. What's amazing to me is as I was looking at this Torah portion, normally I'm in Israel at this time, or just ready to leave, because the Torah portion is Lech Lecha, which means to get out of here, go forth, you know, go forward. And this is usually when we launch and we're going forward to Israel. But anyway, so the Torah portion is Lech Lecha, and let's look at Genesis 12:1, see how it all begins. It says, the Lord had said to Abraham, get out of your country and from your kindred and from your father's house to a land that I'm going to show you. Amazing thing is God didn't even tell him where he was going. He says, I'm not even going to give you a hint. You just start walking, and when you get there, I'll tell you. Okay. It'd have been nice if he had directions so he knew which way to walk, but God just says, you start walking, and I'll show you when you get there. So let's take a look at where he was. Let's go to the PowerPoint. He was in the Ur of Chaldees. So here was the Ur of Chaldees. And he goes all the way up here. If you remember, his son, Haran, died in the fire. And here's this city here, named after his son, more than likely Haran. And then he comes down here, stops at Shechem. We'll talk about that. Goes to Bethel, passes Jerusalem, down to Hebron. But so you can get a current day map here. Let's take a look at this. Here's Iraq. Okay, Ur of Chaldees was around Babylon, and this is right where he was. He goes all the way up through here, through Syria, down through here, and over here to Israel. So I just wanted to give you an idea of exactly where he was and where he was headed. So let's look at Genesis chapter 11, verse 27 and 28. This is talking about Abram's father. It says, these are the generations of Terah. And we see Terah begot Abram, Nahor, and Haran. I meant his brother, I'm not sure what I said concerning Haran, but it was Abram's brother. Abram, Nahor, and who knows what Nahor means? I've told you before. Do you remember? Nahor, what does his name mean in Hebrew? Snorer. He's the first one who snored, mentioned in the Bible. That was his name, means snorer. But anyway, look at this. It says Haran begat Lot. And then it says Haran died before his father Terah in the land of his nativity in Ur of the Chaldees. Now, I want to point something out to you. Let's go to the PowerPoint. Okay, here's this big ziggurat. That is in the Ur of Chaldees, what it looked like, you know, 4,000 years ago when Abraham was there. They knew how to build things. How long did the kingdom last? 4,000 years old, it's still there. Here's our troops climbing that ziggurat a few years ago. So they knew how to build things. But anyway, the Ur of Chaldees, let me mention something to you about that. In Genesis 11, 27, 28, where it says Haran died before his father Terah, in our Western mindset, we think, well, he died before his dad did, right? But this has nothing to do with the chronological event, even though, yes, he did die before his dad did. That's not what the Hebrew is trying to tell you. Let's look at Genesis 11, 27, 28 from another version of the Bible. This is from the literal translation. It says, and these are the births of Terah. Terah hath begotten Abram, Nahor, and Haran. And Haran hath begotten Lot. And Haran died in the presence of Terah, his father, in the land of his birth, in Ur of the Chaldees. So when it says that he died before his father, in other words, that's saying he died in front of his father. Now, the Hebrew word is panay, which refers to the face. So it's like it was right in front of his father's face that he saw his son die. So you can see the depth of the meaning when you look into the Hebrew as far as what was really going on. Now, the word Ur of the Chaldeans refers to the Babylonians, but the word Ur is fire. Okay? So it, really what this is saying is Haran died in the presence of his father's face in the fire of the Chaldeans. You following me? So let's take a look, and first, let me go to Joshua, chapter 24, verse 2. Let's put up that PowerPoint. What do we know about Abram's father, Terah? It says, Joshua said to all the people, so this is several hundred years later, they're about to enter the promised land, and look what Joshua says. Joshua said to all the people, thus saith the Lord God of Israel, your fathers dwelled on the other side of the flood in old time, even Terah, the father of Abraham and the father of Nahor, and they served other gods. So Abram's father served other gods. That's what it's plainly saying. So let me read to you what Jewish history says concerning this whole incident with Haran dying so you can get a better picture of what really happened. Terah was an idol maker. And guess who he made idols for? Nimrod. Okay, they lived at the same time. And on one occasion, he was embarking on a journey, Terah was. So he left young Abraham to mind the idol shop in his absence. So now Abraham is in charge of Terah's idol shop. When a customer came in to purchase one of the idols, Abraham asked him, how old are you? The customer would answer that he was 50 or 60 years old. And Abraham would say, woe to this man. Abraham would cry out, he is 60 years old, yet he wants to prostrate himself before an idol that's only one day old. And the customer would leave in shame. Well, once a woman entered a shop carrying a bowl of flour as a gift to the gods. Take the flour and offer it before the idols for me, she told Abraham. So he took a stick after she left. Abraham took a stick and he smashed every one of the idols except the biggest idol. Then he put the stick in the hand of the biggest one. When his father returned, he asked, "Who smashed all these idols?" Abraham replied, "Why should I try to conceal the truth from you, Dad? A woman entered a shop with a bowl of flour, told me to offer it to the idols. I placed it before them, and one said, 'I'm going to eat it first.' The other said, 'I'm going to eat it first.' The biggest one took a stick and smashed all the others." And Abraham's father, Terah, said, "Why are you lying to me?" So Terah demanded, "Do idols have intelligence?" is what Terah, the father, said. Abraham replied, "Well, let your ears hear what your mouth is saying, Dad." And so, basically, what happened concerning Haran, as you're very familiar, let's look at Genesis 10, 8 through 10. Let's go to the notes here. I'm going to follow this story up here with some facts. It says, "And Cush begat" who? Nimrod. "He began to be a mighty one in the earth. He was a mighty hunter before the Lord. Why it is said, 'Even as Nimrod, the mighty hunter before the Lord,' the beginning of his kingdom was" what? Babel. This is referring to Babylon. This is where the Ur of Chaldees was. You remember in Daniel chapter 3 and verse 20, who was there? Nebuchadnezzar. He commands the most mighty men that were in his army to bind Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and cast them into the Ur of Chaldees. Okay, the burning fiery furnace. So what you see, what actually happened is that Terah was so mad at Abraham for smashing all of his idols. The story goes, he complained to Nimrod. And so Nimrod, because this is where the whole burning fiery furnace comes from, okay, he went to throw Abraham in the fiery furnace. Okay, so Abraham is in the fiery furnace, just like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were. And Nimrod turned to his brother Haran and said, "Do you believe in the same God that Abraham, your brother, believes in?" And Haran was waiting to see if Abraham survived before he would say. Okay. Well, evidently, they took Abraham out. He was fine, just like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were, and they threw Haran in the Ur of the Chaldees, and he died before his father's presence. So here, Terah, the idol maker, saw his son die because of his sins, making idols. He's thrown in the Ur of Chaldees in his father's presence, as the scripture says. So Jewish history just kind of fills in the blanks here. And so that's why they all decided to leave and they went on their journey around also, besides the fact that God told them it's time to get the heck out of here. So let's take a look at Genesis 12, verse 2 and 3. It says, "And I will make of you a great nation." This is an interesting word here, make, in Hebrew. God says, "I'm going to mold you. I'm going to change." In other words, God's going to make a change in Abram's life. He says, "I'm going to make you a great nation. I'm going to bless you. I'm going to make your name great. You're going to be a blessing. I'm going to bless those that bless you, curse those that curse you. And in you shall all families of the earth be blessed." Everyone's very familiar with that verse. But here's, I want you to look at a promise to Abraham's seed. It says in Genesis 12:5, in just a minute here, look at this. Abram takes Sarah, his wife, and Lot, his brother's son, that's Haran who died, and all their substance that they have gained. And then look at this. It says, "And the persons that they have obtained in Haran, and they go out to go towards the land of Canaan, and they come into the land of Canaan." Now that's from the Young's literal translation. When we see they took with them the persons that they've obtained, what does that mean? What comes to our mind? What do you mean persons that they obtained? Well, let's look at this verse in another translation. It says, "Abram took Sarah's wife and Lot, his brother's son, and all their substance that they had gathered, and the souls that they had gotten in Haran, and went forth to the land of Canaan." There's another verse that says, "all of the servants that they have gotten." Okay, so what is it? Is it the souls, the servants, the people? Actually, what this implies is Abram had won several people to the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. These are souls that he had gotten who now believed in the one true God. So he's not taking just servants or slaves. He's taking people that he had led to his God. That's what this is talking about here. Now, one of the things that's interesting, it talks about the souls that he had gotten in Haran. How many of you heard about people called evangelists? Let's say you have Mr. Super or Mrs. Super Evangelist. And from the day they were born, when they came out, the doctor got saved. Okay? This is little baby evangelist his entire life. And let's say he lived for 70 years and he won one person to the Lord every day of his life. Would that be pretty good? Look at this PowerPoint here. So if you spent 365 days a year for 70 years, that's how many people that you would have to the Lord. Now, does that look pretty good? Actually, that's horrible. And I'm going to tell you why that's horrible. It is better to disciple people than just lead them to the Lord and let them go on their way and never see him again. I'm going to show you the simple math of this. Do you know you are better off if you don't get anyone saved until you're 20? And then from 20 years old, you spend the next 30 years every year just discipling one person. You are better off spending an entire year with one person and discipling that person so that the next year both of you can get one person and disciple one person. And the next year, do you want to know how fast that happens? This is what's sad, because the church has been around for 2,000 years and we haven't done a very good job, really. Sure, there's a lot of evangelists, but they're not discipling. Let me show you the math here. Let's go to the next PowerPoint. Okay, the first year you have one person. So at the end of that year, there's now two people, right? And then both those two people each take one, so the next year you have four. At the end of 10 years, there's 512 people. That doesn't look like a lot of progress, especially compared to the, 25,000 the other person had. This is just 10 years. But look what happens the next 10 years. The next 10 years, you end up 524,000 people after just 20 years. By just you spending one year with one person and training that person to get one person the next year. So what happens in the next 10 years? 30 years. Now you started, let's say, at 20. You're now 50 years old. At the end, your 31st year, you'll have 1,073,000,000 people brought to the Lord. This isn't just 30 years. If everyone would just spend 1 year with one person and train them to do the same. I mean, there's 6 billion people in the world. You know, that's just like, two more years, three more years, and you'll have all 6 billion. So the key is not evangelism. The key is discipleship. But that takes commitment to people. A lot of people don't want to take the commitment. They don't want to change the dirty diapers. You know what I'm saying? I mean, seriously. But if we really want to see the world saved, we have to get more concerned with discipleship, training others to train others to train others, rather than just building up one person's kingdom. Look how many people notches I have on my belt. Ephesians 4:11, we're to train you to do the work of the ministry. People may complain, well, how come you're not doing this and doing that? My response usually is, well, how come you're not? I mean, if it's such a big concern, you do it. You know, we all got things to do. Okay, but anyway, let's go on. Genesis 12, 6 and 7. Abram passes through the land to the place of Shechem, to the plain of Moreh. That's another English word for that is teacher, basically. This is where the teacher, the plain of Moreh. It says the Canaanite was then in the land, and the Lord appeared to Abram. And look at this. We're going to look at a promise to Abraham's seed that I talked about, or Abram's seed at this time. It says this. It says, to your seed will I give this land. And there he built an altar to the Lord who appeared to him. Wow. So where did he go? Let's take a look at this next PowerPoint. Right here, those of you that go on the Israel trip, you're going to go here. Those that have gone on the Israel trip, no, we've been here. This is around Ishmael, and you're looking over at Mount Gerizim, Mount Ebal. This is Shechem right in the middle. We're talking Genesis, guys. We're talking 4,000 years ago. You'll be able to look at these things. But there's an amazing place in Ishmael called the Three Seas. That's S-E-A-S, where you can stand if it's not a hazy day, and you can see the Dead Sea, the Sea of Galilee, as well as the Mediterranean Sea. And I can see Abraham standing right there on Ishmael looking and seeing the three seas, and God tells him, everything you see, S-E-E, is going to be for you. What I think is so incredible is that's the very land that they want to create the Palestinian state out of. You see, people don't make the connection to what's going on here. Let me put an overlay of the PowerPoint here and I'll show you. See, right here is Itamar. This is where, let me just see something. Yeah, this is Itamar right here. And here's Mount Gerizim. You got Mount Ebal. You've got Elon Moray. Elon Moray is very significant. And you can see Elon Moray from Itamar when you're looking at it. And this is the very place where Abram built his first altar in the plain of Moray, Elon Moray. That's where it is. So let's, but now look at this. Here's what I want you to think of. He said this. He said, to your seed, I'm going to give this land in Genesis 12, right? Everyone read that? Well, look at Galatians 3:16. Now, the promises were spoken to Abraham and to his seed. He doesn't say to seeds, plural, as of many, but as of one, to your seed, which is who? Now, tell me this. If you're the Messiah, God created the heavens and the earth, you're the Messiah, and God said to the Messiah, this is all your land, and then the nations of the world tell God that his son cannot have that land. The land of Israel belongs to Messiah, every inch of it. Okay, so it's scary when the nations try to take land away that belongs to God and his son. All right, let's look at Matthew 1:1. This is why it says here, a record of the genealogy of Yeshua the Messiah, the son of David, the son of who? Okay, it's obviously his dad was Joseph. I mean, in theory, back then at that time, you know, from one standpoint, his not his natural father, but his family father. But plainly, it's when it says the son of David and the son of Abraham, it's referring to he is the king, okay? That's what David was, the king. Abraham, the father of the faith. He's making this connection that he's the one who's going to inherit the land and be the one to rule over the land. These are both messianic titles. The son of David, the son of Abraham are messianic titles. Now, I want to tell you another story that was in Jewish literature that was around the same time as Jesus was. Jesus was very familiar with this story. Whether it's true or not isn't what's important. The story was going around, okay? I happen to believe it's true, but here's what it says. As you know, they like to speak in parables. The story goes, this is a parable that was told. There was a king who desired to build and lay foundations. He dug constantly deeper and deeper, but he only found a swamp. At last he dug and he found Petra. Now you know what Petra means? Bedrock. And he said, on this spot, I will build my foundations. So the Holy One, blessed be he, desired to create the world, but sitting and meditating upon the generation of the flood, he said, how shall I create the world, seeing that those wicked men will only provoke me? But as soon as God perceived that there would arise an Abraham, he said, behold, I have found a Petra, a bedrock, upon which to build the foundations of the world. Therefore, he called Abraham the rock. Is that true? Let's look. Look at Isaiah 51, verse 1 and 2. What does God say? Listen to me, you who follow after righteousness, you who seek the Lord, look to what? The rock you were cut from and to the hole of the pit you were dug from, look to who? Abraham. This is Hebrew parallelism. It's showing you that Abraham was called the rock. Your father and Sarah who bore you, for he was but one. I called him, I blessed him, and made him many. This helps put in perspective now when you understand the Jews knew that Abraham was the rock, okay, and that God was going to build everything on that foundation. You go to Matthew 16, 16 through 18. Simon Peter answered and said, you're the Messiah, the son of the living God. Remember, the two messianic titles is the son of David and the son of Abraham. And so Yeshua answered him and said, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. I also tell you that you are, and here the word is Peter, which is Petros. Petros is not Petra. Petros means a little stone, a little pebble. So he says to Peter, you are a little pebble, but upon this Petra, I will build my assembly. Who is the Petra, the bedrock, is Abraham. That is who is the rock, not Peter. I would hate to have a church built on a pebble, okay? Abraham is the father of the faith. And then it says, the gates of Sheol will not prevail against it. Sheol does not mean hell. It means grave. Okay? In other words, the gates of the grave will not prevail against it. First off, I don't have time because I have too much to cover. Way too much to cover. Oh, good grief. Anyway, how many of you have been attacked by a gate? Okay? Gates don't attack. In other words, the gates of the grave won't prevent us from attacking and the resurrection of the dead. But anyway, let's go to Genesis 13, 1 through 4. Oh, let me show you this. If you go on our trip to Israel, you will see where Yeshua made that comment. This is what they were looking at when he said to Peter, you're a little rock and upon this bedrock. Okay, this is one of the locations we go to. If you join us, you'll be able to see this. But let's go on. Genesis 12, 10 says there was a famine in the land. So Abraham continues down to Egypt. Genesis 13, 1 through 4, he's now coming up out of Egypt. And he's heading back to the very first place where he offered sacrifice to the Lord. Genesis 13, 14 through 18. I don't have time to read all these. You can study it when you get home. But you can see he dwelt in Mamre, which is in Hebron. So let's put up the PowerPoint, and I'm going to show this picture of Hebron. You can't see the cave of Machpelah. Well, if you go with us again on the Israel trip, you're going to be right at these places that are 4,000 years old. You're going to see where Abraham and Isaac and Jacob are buried and their wives. Okay, let's go to Genesis 14. This is quite fascinating. It says here that Abraham, remember when Lot was taken captive? Okay, and so Abraham takes like 318 of his trained servants, and it says they pursued them to Dan. You'll look on your notes. You can see where it says he pursued them to Dan. So let's go to our PowerPoint. Dan was way up here. They were down here, and he pursued them all the way to Dan. Is right on the Lebanon-Syrian border. This is one of the other places we go on our Israel trips. As a matter of fact, believe it or not, I mean, you're reading Genesis, guys. They found the very gates of Dan. And I'm going to show it to you. This is one of the places I like to go. This is adobe brick, 4,000 years old, the original gates of Dan. I'll bring it in closer. But these rocks, they said they never touched. They unearthed them. These are the actual rocks Abraham would have walked on 4,000 years ago. But you'll see this adobe brick, the original gates of Dan from 4,000 years ago. Let's see. Genesis 14 through 18, we'll see that Melchizedek is the king of Salem. And he brought forth bread and wine. He was the priest of the Most High God. If you remember, during Moses' time, there was to be a separation between kings and priests, you know, for 1,500 years. The tribe of Judah were the kings. The tribe of Levi were the priests. But before that time, we have an individual who was both king and priest. The king of Salem was short for Jerusalem. He was the king of Jerusalem, and he was also a priest. We see that in Psalm 76, 2. Where it says, in Salem is his tabernacle, his dwelling place is in Zion. Zion and Jerusalem or Salem were all the same thing. In Zechariah 6, 12 through 12 and 13, it talks about this man whose name is the branch, which is referring to Yeshua. And look at the next underline. It says, he shall be a priest on his what? Throne. So here again, we have someone who can fulfill both roles of king and priest. But there's this other king lurking about in Genesis 14, and that is the king of Sodom. And if you look in Genesis 14, 21, after Abraham captures everybody, brings it back, what does the king of Sodom say to Abram? Give me what? The people. Another translation says, give me the souls. Give me the prisoners. Sodom is a type of Satan. He doesn't want all the property. He wants the people. Okay? But what do we know? Abram said, you know, forget it. You know, I don't want even the property. You could have the property. Give me the people. In Genesis 15, 13, again, God appears to Abram and he says, know of a surety that your seed will be a stranger in the land that is not theirs. And again, I can't help but put Yeshua there or the Messiah there as the seed. And he was a stranger even in his own land. In Genesis 15, 17 and 18, it talks about this covenant God made with Abram. The sun went down. It was dark. There was a smoking furnace, and there was a burning lamp that passed between them. Can you imagine a burning lamp passing between them? I didn't know lamps could walk. But look at this. It says, the same day the Lord made a covenant with Abram. Now notice his name is Abram, not Abraham. to Abram, and he said, to your seed have I given this land. Again, this is referring to Yeshua the Messiah. Well, look at Isaiah 62:1. I think this is incredible in light of this verse. It says, for Zion's sake, I'll not hold my peace. For Jerusalem's sake, I'll not keep rest until the righteousness there go forth as brightness. And look at this. The Hebrew word for salvation is Yeshua. And so it says, and Yeshua as a lamp that burns. I believe Yeshua was that lamp, that fire that walked through the parts, saying he would be the one who would back up the covenant to Abram. In Genesis 16:16, we see Abram was 86 when Hagar bore Ishmael to him. But in Genesis 17:1-2, it was 13 years later when he's 99 that the Lord appears to Abram and he says, walk before me and be perfect. Well, in Genesis 17:5-8 is where he says, now, he's already born Ishmael. It's been 13 years, but it's at this point, God changes his name from Abram to what? Abraham. And he says, I'm going to make you fruitful and I'm going to establish my covenant with you. And then in Genesis 17:15-17, God says to Abram, as for Sarah, your wife, you shall not call her name Sarai, but Sarah is going to be her name. And so I want to show you this. Let's go here. What does the top say? That is God's name, the Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, Yahweh. Here was Abram. What does God do? He gives Abram a letter Hey, and he gives Sarah the other letter Hey from his name. So it's like God is creating them something new. He's imparting part of his name into Abram, part of his name into Sarah to become Abraham and Sarah. So that's what God is doing. He's putting his name upon them like we do when we say the priestly blessing. Now look at this. It says, Abram fell on his face and basically he laughed out loud and he says in his heart, shall a child be born to him that's 100 years old and shall Sarah that is 90 years old bear? I think it's interesting that Abraham laughs out loud and says in his heart, is this possible? And he doesn't get rebuked. But Sarah laughs in her heart and he says, you laughed. Oh, no, I didn't. Oh, yes, you did. Well, you know what the Hebrew word for laugh is? Remember, and they called him Yitzhak, okay, because Isaac's name in Hebrew means laughter, okay? He thought it was funny that a 100-year-old and a 90-year-old could bring forth birth. They both laughed, so they named their son Laughter. Well, God got the last laugh. You know why? Let me show you. This is the word for laughter, Yitzhak, which is what Isaac was named after. Well, every Hebrew letter is also a number. And it so happens that's 100 and that's 90. And so you have a 100-year-old and a 90-year-old, and what do they produce? Chet in Hebrew is life. And so his life came about. Only God could do something like that. So to me, this is why looking at the Torah from a Hebrew perspective can be so much fun. Do you want to have some more fun? All right, let's take a break. Let's stand. And those of you that are live streaming, you can take a break as well. Let's pray. Father, we just thank you so much for your Torah. We went through that lightning fast, but thank goodness we got notes. And Father, I just pray that you would bless everyone listening and watching, that you would just strengthen them and encourage them to walk the walk in this day that we live in. Father, we pray for any tithes and offerings that are coming in, that you truly, not only that you would bless those that give, but really we're looking toward you. We want to bless you. We want to be a blessing and take your Torah to the whole world. And we thank you for those people all over the world that are receiving your Torah. And we pray that they would disciple others, that they would tell others about coming and listening to your word as it spread across the world. And so we thank you for those that are giving their tithes and offerings, either live streaming or locally, Father. And we truly do pray that it would be a blessing to you. In Yeshua's name, amen. Together, blessed are you, Lord our God, creator and king of the universe. You have blessed us with your Torah of truth. You have blessed us with the whole counsel of your living word by the power of your Holy Spirit through the completed work of Messiah Yeshua. You alone have planted among us life eternal. Blessed are you, Lord our God. Amen. Take a break.
All right, again, we'd like to thank everyone that is coming here locally, as well as those that are live streaming from all over the world. And so I thank you. And now for those that are come from all over the world, would you raise your hand? We'd like to have a gift for you. All right, right over here. Let's give them a big hand, the people that are visiting. Keep your hands up, and the usher will come and bring you some brochures. In the meantime, we'd like to find out where you're from. Where are you from? Mill Creek. Marysville. Edmonds. Arlington. Wow, let's give them a big hand. That is a long drive. Tampa, Florida. Woohoo! Yes, over here, yes. Seaback, that's a beautiful area. Yes. Hawaii. Yes. Buckley. All right, that's close. Hawaii definitely is incredibly far. I see hands over here. Yes, where are you from? Oh, yeah, Tenasket. And Marysville. Where are you from? Redmond. Winthrop. Wow. We're talking long drives. Yes. Dallas, Texas. Wow. Fantastic. To me, it's just so incredible with people from all of the United States. Oh, I see another hand. It's over here on the front. Yes. Seattle. And where are you from? Burien in West Seattle. All right. Well, it is so great to have people from all over the United States, all over Washington, who not only can live stream, but they drive hours and hours just to get here. And so we just want to honor you and thank you for coming and joining us. But who wants to honor the Lord? Let's stand. And who do we got? Where's our shofar blower? Oh, there he is. All right. We want to listen to the sound of the shofar. I really believe God can speak to us even through the shofar blasts. Remember in Revelation it says, he who has ears to what? Hear, let them hear. And hear means to hear and obey. And so let's just ask God that he would give us hearing ears. Father, Avinu, Malkenu, our Father, our King, we thank you so much for your Torah, for your word. And you even say in your word to lift your voice as a shofar or as a trumpet. Father, even as Brian, after he plays the shofar, when we begin to sing your praises and give you all the glory and honor you deserve, may our voices be a returned echo and a shofar up into heaven. Father, that the angels and you, the heavenly host, could hear our voices, recognizing you as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And we ask this in Yeshua's name. Amen.
Thank you.
Just fill this house with your presence. Father, this is your Shabbat. This is your appointed time when you ask us to meet with you and you would be here in a special way. We are your children, and Father, as your kids, we want you to know that we love you, that we put you first and above all else. Father, but as your children also, there are many of your kids here who have needs. There are physical needs. And Lord, we just lift all the people up that are here in live streaming that have any physical needs. They can just raise their hand up to you, Lord, and say, help. Father, and for those who are standing in for other people who are sick or infirmed in the hospital, we just want to stand in for them as well and lift them up to you. Father, for those that have financial needs, we just pray, Lord, that you would open the windows of heaven and meet those financial needs of your kids, of your people all over the world that are with us right now. Father, we pray that this year of triple blessing would be a blessing to them, that they would have all kinds of new opportunities financially to help them, to bless them, to help sow into your kingdom. And for those who have spiritual needs, Father, that are people that are away from you, Father, we always want to lift up those kids, your kids that might be rebellious, Father, that they would give up their bitterness and their jealousy and envy, and they would come to you with all their heart, mind, soul, and strength. And we lift up your nation of Israel, where you shall come and reign on your holy throne in an undivided city of Jerusalem. And Father, we just thank you. We pray for the political leaders, the religious leaders, the military leaders, Father, that your nation, your people would turn back to you, back to their Torah with all their heart, mind, soul, and strength. Protect them and give them wisdom in this day. And we ask this in Yeshua's name. Amen. Amen. Thank you. You can be seated. All right. I want to give as much time as I can to Art. So I'm just going to make this announcement that Vicki and I have known Patty and Art. I was just asking, I think over 10 years, something around there. The first time I met them, I went down to Oregon. This lady that was coming to El Shaddai 10, 11 years ago said, you got to come down to Oregon. So I went down to Oregon and went to a three-day seminar. And then after a while, then I thought, okay, well, we ought to have Art here. So Art has and Patty have come up here a couple of times and have done their seminars. And then Vicki and I and about 10 other people from El Shaddai went all the way up to Alaska and went through their two-week seminar. And then since then, well, Art has been here twice speaking. I've been up there twice besides the School of Ministry, Vicki and I, and speaking. And we just love Art and Patty to pieces, and we're so glad they're here. But Art.
Thank you, Mark. You don't know how good it is for us to be back here. El Shaddai has changed our lives, as maybe it has yours too. Is that right? Thank you, Mark and Vicki, and all of the wonderful things you guys do. And may this be a year of at least a triple blessing for everyone here. Bless you guys. I still remember the phone call years ago. Well, at first I remember these 90-some people that came with Mark and Vicki down to Oregon. What is this? And then the phone call for this Sabbath congregation to come all the way from Alaska to Seattle to Tacoma area to teach. And says, all right, let's go. And I had no idea what the Lord had in mind. It's incredible what God has done in introducing us to Hebrew Roots and the changes that it's been made in our lives. The richness of God's word has just been exponential. Is that true for you too? Yeah. Sometimes you get to thinking you know something and then you listen to Mark speak. Oh. So much more to learn. And that's the beauty of what God is doing. And the more we learn, the more we see how God knows everything that's happening. All the little things that Jesus did while he was here. Why did he say that? And then as you study deeper, you see that he had a plan. He had something in mind. So let me go ahead and start into what we're going to be doing this morning in introducing Biblical Foundations of Freedom and the ministry of Jesus this morning. Jesus came to show us who the Father is. He came to show us that he is the exact image of the Father and that we can define who God the Father is and what his kingdom is and what his will on earth is by looking at Jesus and what he did. Today in the church, we have all these conversations about law versus grace and the law has passed away and we're in the age of grace, the church age. And do you think maybe Jesus understood the conversations today that have been going on for years? Maybe that's why he said some of these things. Because when did grace start? In the Torah portion today, clear back in Genesis, didn't it? It's not a new dispensation. Jesus and the Father are one. Why does Paul teach in Romans 3 that the God of the Jew and the God of the Gentile is one? One God, one set of rules, one Bible, one Torah for all. Does that make sense? When Paul is teaching monotheism, the church today needs to understand that there's one God, not three. One. That makes the whole Torah come alive. Makes the New Testament or the renewed covenant come alive when you understand those things. God doesn't want us to just know who he is. He wants us to personally experience him. That's why he said in John 8:31 and 8:32, if you hold to my teachings, then you're really my disciples, and then you'll know the truth, and the truth is going to set you free. Folks, just don't be afraid of the if, thens, and buts. There's answers behind every one of those things for our needs in our life in the if, thens, and buts of God's word. And the word know here means to personally experience. It's just not head knowledge, folks. He wants us to know him at that intimate marriage covenant level, not just a passing acquaintance. And in Revelation 12:11, we learn the importance of our testimonies. It says that they overcame Satan by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimonies because they were speaking what Jesus did. As they learn to really hear, as they learn to do, to obey, they learn the power and the secrets and the mysteries in the gospel. And in John 10, when Jesus was talking to the Pharisees, he said, if you can't believe me for who I said I am, look at what I've done. And he said same thing to Philip in John 14. If you can't believe me for what I said, who I said I am, look at what I've done. And shouldn't that be true in all of our lives too? This is a very Hebrew concept. It's not what you say, it's what you do. It's all through the scriptures. And let me tell you a little bit about myself. Some of you know me, some of you don't. But why am I traveling? Why am I teaching things like we're going to go through this morning and the conference for the next 4 days? That'll be up at Beit Tikva. We don't always have our lives planned as they turn out. Things change, don't they? We may have it put together the way we think it's going to happen, but There's forces out there that we don't always understand. We don't always know what to do with. Well, in my life, I was raised in a church, like many of you. Mom took me to church when I was a little baby, dedicated me to the Lord, and always told everybody that I was going to be a missionary to Africa. That was my mom's plans. I don't remember her ever asking me, but that was her plans for me. So I went through the youth groups and all the things in our typical evangelical church that I attended. Even went to the church college back in Indiana, took a pre-seminary course, majored in Bible and psychology and history, and actually enrolled in a church seminary. I lasted about 6 weeks. Didn't last very long. Wasn't what I really wanted to do. Got involved in the business world. Still am. Still very involved in doing things in the business world. And started in a business. And in 1981, we moved to Anchorage. Or Patty and I moved, and we raised our family there, our two sons. And very confident that I knew what the Word of God taught. I have a college degree in Bible. I have to know what it says, right? Well, my life started to change. And in Alaska, it snows a lot, and we like snowmobiles. They got the longer the track and the bigger the horsepower, the more we like them. You can go higher up that mountain. You can go faster. You know, some of you guys recognize that and appreciate that, I'm sure. And in 1997 or 1998, I was riding the snow machine in Anchorage, the mountains of Chugach Range right behind Anchorage, and I tipped the thing over on top of me. I didn't think much about it. It's happened before, but a couple days later, my neck all started to get stiff, and my right arm started to cramp and hurt. And I just wrote it off to stress as some of the things we were involved in at the time. And I went and got some physical therapy, some massage therapy on my arm and shoulder, and the pain went away. But throughout that year, I didn't feel real good. Something was different. My balance was off. And in the fall, my youngest son, Ryan, and I went sheep hunting. We flew a little airplane that we have, clear back up in the Alaska Range, and landed about 3,000 foot elevation, a little piece of grass and gravel up there. I went hunting and had a great time. Got a nice sheep. My son got it. That was better. And when I got back from that trip, all the cramping in my shoulder came back. So I went back to the physical therapy. It didn't help. And after a couple of months, my arm started to wither and losing the strength. And I was getting more and more scared. Lord, what's going on? What's happening? Went to a doctor that specialized in shoulders. He did an MRI on his shoulder, couldn't find anything wrong, and sent me for another MRI and to another type of doctor that specializes in nerves and nerve conduction, a physiatrist. And she sent me for an MRI on my neck. And they found that I had vertebrae and discs in my neck that were crushed, and fragments of the vertebrae were pinching the spinal cord. And she said it was so bad, I shouldn't be alive, I should be dead. The pressure was that extreme. And says, you got to have surgery. You got to get your neck fixed. If you don't, you're going to die. More fear. What do I do? So I went to the elders in my evangelical church and had them lay hands on me and pray. And they prayed, Lord, if it be your will, heal this guy. And you can see a lot of faith in that prayer, can't you? So I went to a friend of mine that has a Pentecostal church and had his elders pray for me. And they prayed, Lord, if it be your will, heal this guy. I says, well, I didn't understand. So in January of 99, I had surgery. They cut me on my neck, went through to my spine, took bone off my hip, and fused three levels in my neck. And I came out of the surgery, the pain had subsided in my arm, my shoulder, it quit hurting. But in many ways, I was worse because my stomach hurt, everything hurt. Everything I ate hurt. And I didn't understand that. I went back to the surgeon, and he says, you know, your neck isn't very good, but it's not causing those problems. I went to a neurologist. Neurologist did their three-hour workup on me and told me I had a disease called peripheral neuropathy because my fingers were getting numb and my toes were getting numb, especially on the right side of my body. But, hey, I can't do anything to help you, and I'm not going to see you anymore. I had just done a debate about same-sex marriage, and she was on the other side, so she didn't want to see me anymore. So I went off to Mayo Clinic in Scottsdale, and they did their big workup in their neurology department. And they call it small fiber neuropathy, a long list of drugs. Take these, they might help. And I read the side effects to those drugs, and I says, Lord, I'm not taking them things. The side effect is worse than what I got. I'll keep what I got. And they told me I had less than 2 years to live. So more fear, more worries, more anxieties. And the stomach kept hurting worse. And as time progressed, I couldn't even wear clothes. I'd put on a polyurethane jacket, and we need warm clothes in Alaska. It's cold up there. And it would make me hurt. My skin would hurt. It would burn like nerve pain. I says, Lord, what's going on? What do I need to do? I went through everything in allopathic or Western medicine, and all they do is give you drugs. And I'm so grateful I didn't take them because I wouldn't be here today if I did. Then I got involved in Eastern medicine and alternative medicine. And mostly alternative medicine treats symptoms too. Doesn't really deal with the root cause of things. And in that process, I learned some things. I learned that it was allergies causing my problems. I had developed over 100 different allergies. My sister then sent me some tapes. She had cancer in her breasts. And these tapes taught her that if she would forgive. Says, Marlene, if you'll forgive, God will heal. Because the bitterness was opening the door to the cancer. When we're angry, when we're full of resentment, when we have fears or worries, those strong negative emotions suppress your immune system. They kill the T cells, the B cells, the macrophage cells, allowing a cold or cancer or anything in between to take over, even allergies. And she says, and this is her testimony, and she says, as I learned to forgive our mom, I'm going to see mom next week. The tumors in one breast cleared up. Then she said, the Lord spoke to her and says, you have some resentment at your mother-in-law. Pray, forgive, deal with it. Do what the word says. She did. And the tumors in the other breast went away. And you know, I thought that was one of the craziest things I ever heard in my life. No way, this can't be true. But I was desperate. I had less than 2 years to live, according to the doctors. So I said, I'll listen, send me the tapes. And I started listening to those tapes, and it just messed my theology all up. I was raised in this evangelical church that says once I got saved, everything was forgiven. I didn't have to, all my past, present, and future sins were automatically forgiven. There's nothing I got to do. You know, that nasty word, work, you know. And our churches today, they run away from it. And they're suffering in their ignorance because they run away from the obedience to God's word. And as I learned to do the simple things, to forgive those that had hurt me, to repent for the crazy things I had done in my life, I'm no different than you, right? We all have the same enemy, don't we? Yeah, we do. As I learned to forgive and deal with some of those things, and I didn't understand it. Nobody taught me how to forgive. Nobody taught me what it was, how to measure whether I'd forgiven or not, or even what bitterness was. See, I learned that bitterness has seven pieces or parts. Any unforgiveness, that's remembering what people have done to you. Any resentment, any anger, any retaliation, any hatred or any violence or murder, And murder is usually with the tongue when we put people down. That's murder. See, those seven things are the pieces and parts of bitterness. And if we've got any of that in us, then we have a root of bitterness, as Hebrews 11 talks about. And that was, Lord, I'm born again. I can't have that problem. It's all done on the cross. Well, folks, Yeshua, Messiah, has made anything at all available. But we still have to do what the Word says. If I don't forgive others, then God cannot forgive me. If I repent, God is faithful and just to cleanse me. There's still things that we need to do. Is that all right? Yeah. So I started doing those things, not understanding how. And there was another verse that kept coming up, 2 Timothy 1:7 says, I haven't given you the spirit of fear, but of power, love, and sound mind. I was controlled by this fear. Fear of the future, fear of dying, the pain, and constant pain. And God says, that's an evil spirit. And I said, wait a minute, I'm a born-again Christian. How can I have an evil spirit? Good and evil can't be in the same place at the same time. You ever been told that? I wasn't owned by that spirit, but I was sure controlled by it. And I learned that it was a sin to have that fear and the worry in me. And that's a hallelujah, folks. That's not a condemnation. Because it gave me the answer to the problem. Hey, Jesus taught, you can repent for sins and get rid of them. That's what his blood is for. But I have to do something. That nasty word, work. That's a beautiful four-letter word, folks. It's a blessing. To be obedient is a blessing because God loves us. He only has our best interest at heart. And when we really understand that, and we look at the Torah and the things he asks us to do, every one of those things is a tremendous blessing if we do it. It's not legalism. It's not a bondage. When I became obedient by my choice, started to forgive, told that spirit of fear to get in the name of Yeshua, Messiah, Jesus, I was blessed. I was blessed only because I was obedient to his word. I could have chosen not to do those things. And I would not have been healed. So as I did those things, as I understood that, the allergies were healed. The neuropathies were healed. Over 100 allergies, multi-chemical sensitivities, environmental illness, and all the neuropathies went away. And then people started asking me, Art, what in the world happened to you? You're not sick anymore. You're not dying. And I says, well, this is what I learned, and this is what I did. And in the lobby of the church, I would start to share, this is what I did. And I'd say, do you want to pray? You need to forgive somebody? And they'd pray, and they'd get well. That's how Wellspring Ministries got started. People kept calling me in my business and wanting to deal with their diseases and their issues like this. They didn't want to buy insurance from me anymore. They wanted to talk about God, and I loved that. It was a good thing. My life changed again because God loves me. Jesus says he's the visible image of the invisible God. So when you see Yeshua, Jesus, you're seeing the Father. They're one. There's one God. One. They're the same. They both love us and care about us so much that they died for us. They gave themselves for us. What greater price, what greater value can God place on you and me? In the business world, we value something by what somebody's willing to pay for it. What was God willing to pay for us? Does that tell you how he looks at you and how he sees you how he cares about you. Never forget who you are in Jesus. So as God did all of that for me, he's not a respecter of persons. If he did have respect to persons, he'd be committing a sin, as James 2 says. So what he did for me, he wants to do for everybody. Right? Is that who he is? Let that build your faith. So that's my testimony of what Jesus has done. And it grows. It continues more and more and more. Jesus said he came to do the works of the Father because they're one. They're not two. He came to show us who the Father really is and what his will on earth by doing what the Scriptures said. The Father sent Jesus to preach the gospel. This is Luke 4:18, Isaiah 61. To save the lost, to heal the brokenhearted, to deliver those in bondages and captivities, to heal the blind and the sick, and to destroy all of the works of the devil, to set aside, to destroy everything Satan did. To bring us an abundant life. Remember, Satan came to kill and destroy. In my background, if somebody had cancer, they would say, God gave me this cancer or these allergies to test me. Is that what God does? Absolutely no way. Would you give a disease to one of your kids to test them to see if they loved you? So how could we ever say that about a loving, kind Heavenly Father? Folks, when we examine the Bible from Greek hermeneutics, we make huge mistakes. We need to go back to a Hebrew thought process and the Hebrew hermeneutics. See, in the Greek thinking process, they approached the Bible the same way as they did their mythology. They believed it was maybe 25% true and 75% a story. Well, they brought that same thought process into how the early Christian Greek scholars looked at the Bible. So they call most of the Bible a story and not the real truth, the real word of God. How did Jesus do his work? He taught and he demonstrated repentance and forgiveness. He just didn't talk about it. He actually did it. He cast out demons. He healed all the diseases. He raised the dead. He did the things of Luke 4:18 and Isaiah 61. And that should be our purpose and our goal in life too, man. What we do all day long, this is our job for each and every one of us. Jesus says, if I don't do the works of my Father, don't believe me. That's where we should be too. Jesus said, if you've seen the Father, you've seen me. I and the Father are one. Again, why is Jesus saying all of these things? You think maybe he anticipated what was going to be going on in the church today and some of our doctrines? You bet he did. Jesus says, if you know me, you should also know the Father. For this purpose was the Son of God manifested, to destroy everything Satan does. Where do diseases come from, folks? God or the devil? So it isn't God, is it? It's from Satan all the way through. Our understanding of who God the Father is and what his will on earth is should and must be formed by who Jesus is and what he did. If it's not, then we've fallen into a trap set by the devil. Jesus is perfect theology, folks. So who is Jesus to you? He becomes whatever, whoever you want him to be. You need a doctor? You need a business advisor? Need a best friend? He wants to be your groom. That's the type of relationship he wants. The intimacy of marriage is a relationship that he desires with each of us. So we've looked at the works of God and of Jesus. Let's look for a minute at the works of Satan. Satan came to blame and belittle God. Started right on in Genesis with Adam and Eve to accuse God of withholding something good. Everything Satan has always done is to accuse God, to belittle God in some way or another. Every temptation starts out there. All sin and rebellion comes from Satan. All the works of the flesh come from Satan. Deceptions, false religions, false doctrines, accusation of the brethren, all temptation. Does God ever tempt us? No, never. He can't. He won't do that. Persecution of Christians comes from Satan. Satan comes to kill and destroy, never God. Satan causes diseases and sickness, never God. So does this define who our enemy really is, folks? Satan causes infirmities, never God. Satan causes storms. The earth can cry out at the weight of sin, folks, but God doesn't bring judgment in that manner. Satan and sin cause the earth to cry out. How often do you hear, even in your insurance policies, acts of God? Folks, it's not an accurate statement. God doesn't do that. Remember, Romans teaches us that it's the goodness of God that leads people to repentance. It's His goodness. It's not punishment. Satan brings death. Satan hinders our prayers. Satan brings the unbelief, the occult, the fear, the rejection, the jealousy, the envy, and the bitterness. And in the evening portions of our seminars, we continue throughout the week, we'll be working through bitterness and jealousy and rejection, fear, unbelief in the occult, and show you how Satan brings those things into our lives. But more importantly, we're going to show you how to have victory over them and how to have victory over the things that come with the bitterness, like the diseases that are caused by those toxic negative emotions. So the next logical thought process here is, what are your works? In Matthew 16, it says that every one of us is going to be rewarded according to what we do. Folks, the laws of sowing and reaping are a biblical concept. I was taught that, now that's just Old Testament, not the New Testament. New Testament's all grace. Well, folks, God is grace. Right back from the very beginning, God is grace. He's never changed. He has been grace, He will be, and He is grace today, and He always will be grace. But in part of His grace, we reap what we sow. That's grace too, folks. We learn. Do you learn more from your mistakes or from your victories? Yeah, if you're like me, it's your mistakes. That's grace, folks. And in our mistakes, what does He do? Don't we have the blood of Jesus? They had the blood of bulls and goats that always pointed to the blood of Jesus. He's always had a way for forgiveness from the very beginning. Grace, folks. God hasn't changed. In Revelation 2 and 3 is a story of seven churches. And He went to each of those churches and had things, said, hey, I like these things, but I have these things I'd like you to take care of. Now, who's the church? Aren't we? Aren't believers part of the church? So that Revelation 2 and 3 has an application to you and me. And He promised 10 different rewards. He said, if we overcame, then we could eat of the tree of life and not be hurt in the second death, to eat of the hidden manna, to receive a white stone, to receive a new name, have power over the nations, to be clothed in white raiment, confess His name before the Father, and I will not blot your name out of the book of life, and invited to sit in the throne with Jesus. I'm not sure I understand what all of those things mean, folks, but there's some incredible things there. The last one, sit in the throne with Jesus, comes out of Revelation 3:19, where it stands at the door and knock. And if you haven't already studied the Hebrew Ketubah, study the marriage contract, and you'll see that play out. We stand at the door of the knock. The groom, the prospective groom, stands at the door and knock of the bride's home. Jesus is standing at the door of your heart and knocking, wanting to come in. And if the bride wanted to accept the proposal, she'd open the door. This is through her father. Then they would share a cup, blood covenant, cup of wine. Then they would have a meal together and participate in a salt covenant, a friendship, and have another cup. Then they would start writing the document of the ketubah, specify the duties of the obligations of the bride and the groom. The bride was to cleanse herself, to become pure. Who's the bride, folks? That's our job, to cleanse ourselves, to become pure, while the groom goes and prepares a place. The sandal covenant, or the inheritance covenant, all leading to the marriage covenant, folks. It's a process. There's things we do to achieve different levels of relationship. Isn't that fascinating, where God's at? And what he wants with each of us. So this is the process of sitting in the throne with Jesus to become his bride. So there's so many different levels of meaning as you get into the Hebrew hermeneutics. So folks, in 2 Timothy, he talks about becoming a vessel of honor. And he says that let everyone who names the name of Christ depart from iniquities or sins. But in a great house that's in heaven, they're not only vessels of gold and silver, but wood and earth. Some to honor and some to dishonor. What do you want to be? A vessel of honor or a vessel of dishonor? You have a choice. Both are in heaven. It's right back to the different covenant levels. What do you want? Do you want to stop at just getting saved, or do you want to become the bride? I want to be the bride. I want everything there is from God. How about you? I find that exciting, that Christianity just doesn't end at getting saved. That's the beginning. It's the beginning of an incredible relationship, an incredible walk with God. But to become the vessel of honor, we need to purge ourselves from all the iniquities, from all the sins. We need to go to work. That's a good thing, isn't it? Haggai taught us that it was time to rebuild the Lord's house. Who's the Lord's house? Aren't we the Lord's house? In the renewed covenant, he lives inside of us, doesn't he? So we're the temple, as Corinthians tells us. In Haggai, the Lord of hosts, Yeshua Jesus, through Haggai, asks some questions to consider. Why you've sown so much, but you bring in little. You eat, but you don't have enough. You drink, but you're not filled with drink. You're dressed, but you're not warm. You work, but you put your wages into a bag that's full of holes. Go to work, he says. Rebuild the temple. And when I started studying this, I didn't understand. And God woke me up several years ago and told me to go read the book of Haggai. And when I started back in my testimony of when I started to forgive, even though I didn't know what I was doing, when I told that spirit of fear to go, little deliverance, and I had no idea that deliverance was a word I would never use. That's just for those crazy others. When I started to do that, he says, I will be with you. Even just starting it, not knowing what I was doing, I was being blessed because I was getting progressively better and better and better. My immune system was healing and healing over a process of time. This is the same message that Jesus said to Revelation 2 and 3 to the churches. It's the same message he taught in Timothy. Go to work. Deal with these things. Folks, this is the true purpose of the Christian life. Today is for us to go on to perfection. For us today in this life to become holy as God is holy, to become Christ-like. I was always taught we couldn't do that until we died and went to heaven. Folks, God doesn't play games. He doesn't play tricks. He asks us to do it now. These are all written in the present tense. We're to become an overcomer. We're to become vessels of honor. We're to destroy what Satan does today in our lives. This is what God wants each of us to do, to crucify the flesh, that old nature, not just a little bit of it, but all of it. Isn't that what he wants when we're told to do? Well, if he's telling us to do these things, it's got to be possible, because he wouldn't tell us to do something that wasn't. He doesn't play games, right? So we need to learn to place our faith in the delivering power of Jesus and not just the grave, as I was taught. We have victory today in Jesus. This is the power of the Holy Spirit that lives inside of us, the power of the blood of Jesus to sanctify ourselves. And in Romans 3 and 4, it says that we have the power in the name of Jesus to speak into existence that which is not yet. We have tremendous authority, folks. We got to learn to pick it up and do it and use it. So, folks, when we learn we have a sin in our lives, we shout hallelujah. Is that a good thing? No guilt, no shame. Hallelujah. I found something that's in my life that's separating me from God. I recognize it. I can deal with it. Because I can't repent. I can't deal with the sin until I recognize it. I didn't know I was bitter. I had no clue that the resentments that I had were bitterness. I thought that was just human. That's just normal. The anger I had at what the kids did to me in the fourth grade, how they teased me and beat up on me, called me names. I still carried that around. I had no idea that was affecting me, that I still had bitterness from that. The things that my dad did when I was not even yet born, I was still in the womb when he rejected us, the role that that played in my life. I had no clue. As I started to learn, then I learned that I could forgive, I could repent, that I didn't have to have any guilt or shame. Guilt and shame is Satan's tools. God comes in conviction and says, son or daughter. Satan comes and says, you're a bum. You're a loser. You'll never get it right. But God comes and says, son, daughter, love you. I want to be in a closer relationship. Will you deal with this stuff? 2 Corinthians 7:10 says a godly sorrow for our sins only leads to repentance. If you condemn yourself for a sin or something you've done or someone else, you fall into the devil's side of the equation. Then you open the door for Satan to bring his reaping and sowing. I don't want that. I want God's reaping and sowing because it's grace and mercy. Matthew 6:12 in the Lord's Prayer says that we're to pray and ask God to forgive us as we forgive other people. Do you really want to pray that? Well, think about it. Do you really want God to forgive you in the same way that you forgive others? Well, after I thought about that a while, I said, I don't really want to pray this. Because I'm not forgiving others very good. I want something different. And if you don't understand Matthew 6:12, here's Matthew 6:14 and 15. It says, if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you don't, he's not going to forgive you. Wow. And who was this written to? Wasn't Jesus teaching his disciples how to pray? You bet he was. In 1 John 1:9, if we confess, God's faithful and just. But folks, if we don't confess our sins as believers, you're still going to live in the shame for the things you did. It's not what God wants. He doesn't want you to have shame. He's a loving God. He wants to take it. But he says there's something you got to do. You have to apply the appropriate or apply the blood of Jesus. We do that by repenting or forgiving. As Christians, we need to learn to become unoffendable. We don't have the right to be offended, we have the responsibility to give. Because when you become offended, isn't that really a form of bitterness? Look at the emotions around the offense. You're angry. Anger is one of the parts of bitterness. If we allow ourselves to be offended, we've really sinned. So we have to learn, folks, to be doers of God's word. It says, in Romans, it says, for the hearers of the law are just before God. For not the hearers, excuse me, are just before God, but the doers are. James says, be you doers of the word and not hearers only because you deceive yourself. James says, see then that by works a man is justified and not by faith only. Faith alone doesn't save, folks. You have to do what the Word says also. We have a hard time with this in our Western viewpoint. In a Hebrew viewpoint, this is easy to understand because, as Mark said earlier, the word hear, if you really hear, it means you're going to obey. This is what this is teaching, the same concept. So, folks, when I started this morning, I read John 8:32 to you that says that we will personally experience God's truth if we do it. Can I demonstrate this? Can I demonstrate what this means? I need your permission to go here. Okay. I want you to think about somebody that's hurt you. One very specific memory. And with your permission, I'd like to lead you through a prayer to forgive that person. And then I want you to look in your heart and see how that whole situation has changed. Can I do this? Then think of that one thing and then just repeat this prayer. Dear Lord Jesus, I choose in my heart to forgive this person for this specific thing they did. And you name it. I release them. I cancel their debts to me. And in the name of Jesus, I cancel all of Satan's authority over me in this memory. Because I forgive, it's done. Lord, heal my heart. Take the pain out of my heart. And tell me your truth about this memory. Folks, we've learned that if there's pain in a memory, that pain is bitterness. Examine it in your own self. Examine the pain in the memory. You'll see that it is one of those seven parts of bitterness. And when you've really forgiven, the pain goes away. You can measure whether you have bitterness. You can measure whether you've forgiven or not by looking at the pain in the memories. What happened when you prayed that prayer? Did the pain go? Did it feel different? Yeah. If it didn't, then there's more prayers to do. That same thing probably happened more than once. So you keep going to the other times that same thing happened. Now, can we pray again? I want you to think about something that you've done that has shame. Let's do 1 John 1:9 together. Is that all right? Jesus wants the shame. He doesn't want you to keep it. Can we pray? Lord Jesus, I ask you to forgive me for this dumb thing I did. And I forgive myself. Lord, I repent for not keeping your calendar, for not keeping your holy days. Lord, I repent for believing that your word has passed away. That you've changed somehow. I forgive myself for believing the lies that Satan has brought into the church. And in the name of Jesus, I cancel all of Satan's authority over me and all of these dumb things I've done. Lord, come and heal my heart. Set this straight inside of me. And tell me your truth, Lord. Just listen to me. Does that feel good to pray? Every time we pray, every time we forgive somebody, every time we repent for something we've done, we're applying the blood of Jesus. He comes and takes it as far as the east is from the west. He chooses to remember it no more. And then your physiology settles down inside. Your immune system heals. And you get stronger and stronger physically and spiritually every time we work through memories in life. At Wellspring, we see hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people, thousands of people healed every year as we teach them to simply do the simple things that God's Word teaches. From colds to cancer and everything else in between, God heals it all. But He asks us to be obedient because He's a loving, kind Heavenly Father that only wants the best for us. Does that make sense? It's not a bondage. Now, we're going to be continuing this seminar at Beit Tikva Sunday evening, Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday evenings. At Sunday at 6, Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday at 7. Then we're also going to be teaching how to minister at 10, from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. I'd like to invite you all to come. We'll have lots of books and materials there available for you at those times at the conference. It's also going to be on live streamed. So we'll post the live stream address. I didn't have the address until a few minutes ago. It's ustream.tv/channel/Wellspring Ministry. So we'll put it on the web so you can find it. So thanks for letting us come. Hope you can make it up to Beit Tikva for the next 3 days. We'd love to see you take this a lot deeper. Thank you for inviting us.
Amen. Let's pray. Father, we just thank you so much for your Torah, for your word. We thank you for Art and Patty that they came all the way from Alaska to share these truths at this conference. So, Father, we just lift this time up to you right now and pray that you purely would put it deep into our heart, that seed of your word, so we would bring forth much fruit. And we just ask this in Yeshua's name. Amen. Amen. Father, your peace is so overwhelming. And we just thank you that not only have you given us your peace, you want to place your name upon us. This is incredible. We just thank you. And we just ask right now that you truly would place your name upon us. Even as you told Moses to tell Aaron to say this prayer over your people. And in so doing, not only would you bless them, but you would place your name upon them. I can't help but think of Abraham and Sarah receiving each the letter Hey out of your name. As you breathe, as the letter Hey speaks of breath, and you breathe new life in them. Father, right now, as we stand before you and we say this prayer, Father, I pray you would breathe life into every person here and all those that are watching. And this is what you told him to say. Ivarekaka Adonai Vaishmarekka. Ya'er Adonai pan avilecha vichuneka. Yisa Adonai pan avilecha viasem laka shalom. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you his shalom, his peace, b'shem Yeshua HaMashiach. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, go and be blessed. Amen. Thank you for studying with us today. If you have any questions regarding the material discussed, please contact me at my email address. It's pastormark@elshaddaiministries.us. Be blessed and shalom.